from the Circulation COVID team and the University of Texas at Southwestern, and I'm joined by Dr. Robert Hendel from Tulane University. He's the chief of the section of cardiology and the Sydney and Marilyn Lassen chair of cardiovascular medicine at Tulane. Dr. Hendel, thank you for joining us, and thank you for being part of our Circulation COVID updates from the front lines.
I'd like to say my pleasure, but unfortunately, it's not these days.
We know that New Orleans has been particularly affected by this pandemic, and our hope is that in sharing your experience, we might all benefit from the lessons you all have learned in New Orleans.
Thank you for this opportunity. It's been quite an experience. I've been a trustee of the American College of Cardiology for the last 6 years, and as part of that, I'm exposed to, pardon the expression, a lot of communication among leaders in the cardiovascular community throughout the world. And it's been fascinating to watch the emails and listserv communication about common experiences. And at first it was all theoretical, but now that unfortunately New Orleans is really an epicenter and we are way disproportionate in terms of the number of cases, and now we're, even as a city, over 100 people have died up till now, and the projections are really horrible. In fact, yesterday alone, there was a 30% increase in the mortality rate. So we're really inundated with this issue, and I'm really grateful for the communication, especially from the Chinese cardiology associations that have been very willing to share experiences. And we're seeing very similar findings to what they've been reporting, as well as what's going on around the world. And I think the network of cardiologists and the communication that is currently available has been fabulous, as those of us in the trenches have had a lot to deal with a completely unknown organism and an unknown disease.
And maybe you can start there. Can you describe what some of the common cardiovascular complications you all have encountered in New Orleans have been?
Well, first and foremost, we know that we have a very at-risk population. New Orleans, unfortunately, is a largely indigent community, and we have a lot of disease. Obesity seems to be a factor. Certainly cardiovascular disease is a factor, and the incidence of fulminant COVID infections has been higher in that population. So it's not surprising that we have a large number of patients and unfortunately a large number of deaths. Also, a small event like Mardi Gras probably was contributory. That occurred just about a month and a half ago, and we're now seeing massive growth of incidents. So I'm sure that's part of it. So I think it's an issue. The other part that's really concerning is that people with cardiovascular disease, it's well documented now, do much worse when they are infected with COVID. So we're seeing all sorts of things. We are seeing myocarditis, we're seeing heart failure. We're seeing a very interesting phenomenon, which is now being reported pretty worldwide, which is acute changes in the electrocardiogram that really look like a STEMI. No question there's ST elevations, usually in isolated leads, often without reciprocal ST segment depressions. And we've now taken 3 or 4 of these patients to the cath lab and they've had normal coronary arteries. And I was just reviewing this today, and it seems to be a very common finding, whether it's thromboembolic or vasospastic, it's not clear, but clearly this is a higher incidence than what we would have expected.
It's interesting that you mentioned the thromboembolic hypothesis. We've heard a lot of reports from the front lines about various types of thromboembolic phenomenon in these patients. Have you guys seen other presentations of DVTs, PEs, LV thrombi?
Yeah, it's been unbelievable. I would say that's the one real finding that we've seen here in New Orleans. And in fact, I was sending out listserv questions because I had never seen the incidence of intracardiac thrombosis, DVTs. Unfortunately, we just lost a 40-year-old woman without pre-existing conditions due to a massive pulmonary embolism. So it is very common. I think we've had 3 patients with intracardiac thrombi, so this is something like we've never seen before. In reviewing the Chinese literature, they reported, and now we're seeing it worldwide, that COVID-19 patients seem to be procoagulant. They have a very high incidence of elevated D-dimers, and when the D-dimer becomes markedly elevated, say greater than 1 gram per liter, almost all of these patients probably have thrombi somewhere. So we're taking a rather aggressive stance now in suggesting anticoagulation. Our pulmonary critical care colleagues are obviously concerned about the other extreme, which is pulmonary hemorrhage, which has also been observed. A lot of these patients are indeed getting bronchoscopies and are found to have pulmonary hemorrhage. So, you know, right now from a cardiovascular standpoint, I'm more inclined to anticoagulate than to be worried about the hemorrhage, but that's obviously something we're considering.
You know, with the VTEs, are you seeing this as an early presentation more commonly, or is this something that happens later in the disease course?
It's a great question, and we're now starting to screen people. So if anyone has even a moderately elevated D-dimer, they're at least getting lower extremity Dopplers, and we're doing them serially. Whether it's right or wrong, we don't know, but we're doing them at least every 2 or 3 days just to see if there's any notable thrombotic events. We're also doing a fair number of echocardiograms to try to look for problems in RV dysfunction. So we're probably overkill right now in terms of looking for thromboembolic phenomenon, but we're very concerned. The incidence is extremely high and we really don't know what to do. We're looking at fibrinogen levels, we're looking at fibrin spread products, but again, as you know, those are very nonspecific, so we're really not sure what to do. And we've also got some issues, you know, in terms of the treatments. Some of our treatments have impact on the coagulation cascade, especially the antivirals, and we're really not sure what to do. For the most part, we're using unfractionated heparin, a little bit of low molecular weight heparins also. We're avoiding the DOACs and NOACs right now because of concerns about interactions with other drugs, but it's a challenging situation for sure.
One other question on that topic, but have you seen these presentations both in patients who have more mild presentations, maybe floor admissions, or is this more common in your experience in the intensive care unit?
It's hard to know exactly. I mean, anecdotally, we're seeing almost everyone having mild elevation of D-dimers at the very least. We are looking at patients that have, you know, significant elevations, and we are looking for sources of potential thromboembolic phenomenon. So, you know, we're screening a lot more in the ICUs and the really critically ill patients, but even the floor patients that we have that we're observing, we are starting to do a little bit more surveillance, but the incidence is very unknown. We're not doing it on all comers. I do think that D-dimer is an interesting marker, and certainly just a smoldering level of elevated D-dimer is probably not of concern. It's probably related to the overwhelming inflammatory response. But who knows? You know, I'm changing my approach now to be much more pro anticoagulation than just sitting there and watching them after we've had, I think now, a total of 3 PEs and a lot of DVTs.
Now, you mentioned also the ACS presentations, and especially these presentations with ST elevations and normal coronaries.
Yes.
Have you all changed your protocols at all in terms of how you're responding to ST elevations or to ACS type presentations within the COVID population?
Well, yeah, this is a really dynamic situation. I know everyone likes to use the word fluid or dynamic, talking about how we're dealing with COVID-19 patients, but this is a good example. We still have personal protection devices right now. We're sort of getting low, but not out. We have not changed our STEMI protocols at this point. We are still taking patients to the lab, and that's at all 3 of our hospitals. That may change. If we run low on PPEs, we will change that to thrombolytics, but we firmly believe that the data supports the use of primary PCIs, and we're going to try to do that. It's not without a lot of concern. We're really concerned about our healthcare workers, and whether or not this is the right thing to do. But so far, that is our approach. Non-STEMIs is even more of an interesting issue right now. We are definitely deferring those patients. We are not doing angiography and potential intervention on those patients. We are actually looking towards doing pharmacologic myocardial perfusion imaging in a lot of those patients. Sort of the old school days of going back and risk stratifying patients, which may not be ideal, but I think at this point, the risk-benefit ratio, at least to identify the high-risk non-STEMIs and then consider aggressive approaches and intervention in those only. Otherwise, we're going to try to manage them medically. So STEMIs, we're continuing on as we've done. Non-STEMIs, we've modified our protocols a little bit.
You mentioned the PPE use during STEMI cath lab activations. Have you had similar use of PPEs or any changes in protocols during echoes that you've gotten serially or in the other labs?
Yeah, echoes is also a very concerning problem. I spend at least once a day going by the echo lab to talk to our techs. They're obviously very scared, and we're scared for them. They're in direct contact with patients. We've really limited our use of TEEs in these patients. We did have a patient yesterday with presumed endocarditis where it was potentially going to make a difference, so we did do a TEE, but we're avoiding transesophageals as much as we can. Transthoracics, we've switched to doing very limited studies and trying to minimize contact to patients. We're doing assessments of LV function, and when possible, we're using portable bedside echoes given by the fellows. So we're trying to limit those exposures. We screen our echo orders every day, which are usually very extensive numbers, and I'm sure at your place too. But we're trying to really limit the performance of echoes unless it really is going to impact on the care of the individual directly and immediately.
That's really useful. Obviously we're really mindful of your time, but do you have any final thoughts, any other advice you can offer to our viewers and listeners for circulation?
Well, I think this is a time as providers in the cardiovascular community that we really need to keep the exchange of information open, and we need to look out for each other. All of us are very concerned about the well-being of cardiologists and cardiovascular professionals. We've been concerned about burnout and stress in general. Now, when you add COVID-19, it really magnifies this. So we've really got to watch out for each other and be mindful of the stress involved and try to help each other out as much as we can.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hendel. We really appreciate your time. And
thank you.
Wishing you guys the best in New Orleans.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.